Okay, so the structure of a can frame. This is moving from the physical layer to the data link layer. We now know and are very comfortable with getting ones and zeros across the network reliably between devices and how that wiring is hooked up and how it's all done. Now we're going to talk about the frame. How does device A know how to package those ones and zeros and how to understand what they mean when device B sends them a whole block of ones and zeros? It's beyond ones and zeros at this point. We're into the CAN frame, or what's called the data link layer. Okay, this is a diagram stolen from the Kvaser training on the Kvaser website. This shows what we call CAN, classic CAN 2.0A and 2.0B. I'm not going to get into a lot of the history on it, but I will say 2.0A is simply a CAN frame with an 11-bit identifier, and 2.0B is a CAN frame with a 29-bit identifier. A lot of standards, J1939, you almost always have a 29-bit identifier. CAN open always uses an 11-bit identifier, and they define and break that identifier up differently depending on prioritization and source address and things like that that we'll get into to answer your question earlier. So after the identifier, there's some other bits in here that I'm not going to get into real specifically because they're involved with history and other stuff, and you don't really need to understand them to understand the basics of CAN. In a more advanced course, we could talk about every single bit in the CAN frame, but some of these single bits I'm not going to get into right now. I'll talk about, in general, the arbitration field. And then I'll talk a little bit about how the arbitration field may be broken down by J1939, just as an example. Again, it's different in CAN open. I've been recently studying CAN open, and I could talk about the arbitration field in CAN open as well. I haven't prepared anything on that. I'll talk a lot about the data field. There's a little bit about the control field as well, and tell you what's in there, which is basically the DLC, the data length code. Talk about the data field. And then I'll mention the CRC without getting into great detail on how a CRC works. I'll tell you at least what it does. And then there's some closeout stuff. There's an acknowledge bit that we can understand. It's pretty easy to understand. And then there's an end of frame sequence. And then you're done with your CAN frame. That's it. So the one thing to understand about CAN frames in general is a lot of times a CAN bus will be floating. It'll be just nobody transmitting anything. You'll be out here somewhere. And as we've seen, one or more devices could decide, hey, I got a CAN frame to transmit. I'm going to take control of this bus and send it. The first thing they send, as I said earlier, is the start of frame bit. So if you go back to my bitwise arbitration slide, that's where both device A and device B decide they're going to go from recessive to dominant with the start of frame bit. And then they start sending the beginning bits of their identifier. And if two devices or more are on the network, you have an arbitration situation where we're arbitrating for the bus. We're done with arbitration. An important thing to know about arbitration is when you get done with this arbitration field, by definition, by design, locked in stone, there's only one device transmitting on the bus. One device has one arbitration when you get done with your arbitration field. If you still have two devices that think they want arbitration, you got a faulty bus, you got a problem. That doesn't exist. It can't happen because at least in J1939, every device has a different source address. We'll get more into that in a little bit, but different standards have different ways of making sure that only one device has one arbitration by the time arbitration's over. Then you get data, CRC, talk more about that in a minute. Okay, here's some CAN data. Make sense? Know what that is? Yeah? Easy to read? Well, by the end of the day, it will be. You'll be able to take something out of that data stream and know precisely what it means, because I'll show you how to do that. And that's what I call taking the mystery out of CAN. This is a mystery. This is gobbledygook. Nobody knows what this is. But I can tell you in great detail what every single bit in that pattern is and show you how to read it. And hopefully I'm going to do that pretty short order. So this is a grab of data I got from CAN King, which is Kvaser's free bus monitor. That's in our download section. I can show you that all of you should maybe grab and get somewhat familiar with. But it's a pretty simple tool. It just shows you what's on the CAN bus. It doesn't care what the data is. It just shows it to you. All right. So what we have out here is the channel, and I'm just, this is a single channel network. CAN can read from more than one channel if you have more than one CAN bus going at the same time, but here we're just using channel one, channel zero. This is the identifier, and in this case, this is a 29-bit identifier. Now you might say, okay, we got 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7. We got 8, so we got 4 bytes. So 4 times 8 is 16, 32. So, well, no, you got 32 bits, not 29. Well, no, we have 29 because this one here, you're only going to see it as a 0 or a 1. It's just, that's the only way we can represent it. You don't have a clean way in hexadecimal of representing 29 bits. So you got to just say, well, that's going to be a 0 or 1. That's only 1 bit. And the rest of these are 4-bit characters, so that's 29 bits. So that's a 29-bit identifier. Okay, this flag says that it's an extended identifier. It's 29 bits as opposed to 11. Right? This is your DLC. This is your data length code. This is transmitted, if you go back to the previous slide. This is transmitted. I'll show you on the next slide. This is transmitted, and that's that control field. That's transmitted after arbitration. Right? Then you got your data. Depending on the standard, and again, I'll refer to J1939, you can have anywhere from 0 to 8 data bytes. 8 is the maximum that you can have in here. So what are we going to do if we need to send a message more than 8? Well, that's an applications question, and that's going to be transport protocol. Okay. This is a timestamp. This is never on the data bus. This is applied by CAN, depending on what time the data, that particular frame comes in. And this simply says that this frame was received by the Kvaser device as opposed to transmitted. So that's, in a nutshell, what everything on that whole diagram means. There's no mystery there. I will, later in the presentation, show you how to identify and take apart any piece of this data. And I'll also show you exactly what this identifier means and how to take that apart, depending on what application or what industry you're in, or what high-level protocol you're in. I'll show you based on J1939 mostly, but you know, I just don't have time to go into each one of them differently, but you'll get the meaning, you'll get the gist of it from J1939 as an example. A lot of this training here, I had to mention, is training by example, because I can't teach you everything in 2 hours, there's no way, but I can pick an example, I can explain generally how this works in different industries, and then I can dive in and show you the very details in one particular example. Hopefully you can apply that example and understand that enough to apply it to other areas. So the whole idea of this is just to make you much more comfortable with the fact that, hey, I can look at this data that previously meant absolutely nothing, it's gobbledygook, and I actually can understand how to trace that to something meaningful, all the way from the voltages on the wire to a meaningful signal is where we're going today. Okay, here's a blow up, again, based on J1939, or actually NMA 2000, I think this one is, I'm not sure, but they're both pretty much the same. Yeah, this is J1939, of the arbitration field. So bus arbitration is done here. This is the arbitration field. Then we get to the control field, which I said has a couple bits we're going to ignore, and the data length code. Data length code just tells you how many data bytes you're going to have in that frame. So it's 0 to 8. Right? And without getting into what a parameter group number is or how it breaks down, I should say, into these, because this gets pretty specific to J1939, I'm just going to say this is the parameter group number. So we have start a frame, we got priority. Priority is 3 bits. Every message in J1939 has a priority. We now know why, because of bitwise arbitration, right? You got a recessive bit, you got a bit I'm not gonna get into here, and then basically you got a parameter group number. Parameter group number is an identifier for the data that's gonna follow. A particular parameter group number is gonna say, all right, this parameter group number in J1939, you're going to be able to reference a spec that tells you exactly what the data is and how it's broken down by knowing what this parameter group number is. Okay. Following that, you're going to get a source address. That's who's transmitting the data. Every single frame has one and only one device transmitting it on the network, and has one or more, possibly all of the devices, wanting or listening to that data. Now, as we know, a network consists of two wires. So you send a message, any device sends a message on that network, and every device hears that message. Can't be otherwise. That's just a fact, right? And that's one of the beauties about CAN for control systems, is everything on the network has access to all of the same information by nature, by the way it's wired. We can't change that. We don't want to change that. That's a beauty of CAN, right? So priority, parameter group number, source address. If two devices or more are transmitting messages of the same priority, arbitration continues. If two devices or more are transmitting messages with the same priority and the same parameter group number, we get all the way out to here and we still have two devices on the bus thinking that they want arbitration, right? In, at least in J1939 and the protocols based on J1939, every device has to have a unique source address. So in that case, where everything else is the same, the device with what the lowest source address is going to win arbitration. By the time we get here in time, only one device is going to be on the network transmitting. We're going to transmit a DLC code. All the receivers know what the parameter group number is, so they know what to look for in the data, and they're going to read the data. So that is the data link layer. That's the essence of the data link layer.